All right, what's up? Well, I'm Angela Yee, and I'm really excited. I know this feels, you know, formal because you look really nice, and I'm wearing my quarantine outfit.
You look perfect.
But August Alsina is here. Hey, August.
Hi, Angela.
And I know it's weird. Like, I just feel like I've watched you grow up from when you first, you know, came out as an artist and to see where you are today. Your album just came out as we're filming this yesterday.
Yes.
And there's 27 songs.
27.
Yeah, State of EMERGEncy.
Yes.
Part 3.
Mm-hmm.
So let's get into it because we were discussing how, first of all, it's been a while since you've been doing interviews.
Absolutely.
And you even said you're like a little nervous.
I am. I'm trying to, I'm sure it's evident. I'm trying to, you know, calm myself down a little bit. You know, as exciting as it is when you get to put out music and express yourself through your art, the amount of energy that you receive from it and from people is a lot to take on. The same way they say about God, when two or more are gathered in His name, that's when you channel and bring in the presence of God. And I feel like it's the same way with people when the energy and intention is set on you, you know, whether good or bad, you feel that. It's exciting and invigorating, but it, you know, it's a little nerve-wracking at times.
It's part of the process. And you put out the documentary series also.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a 5-part docuseries. And I feel like we really got to learn so much about you. I know we know some things about you, which really connects people to your music.
Yeah.
Just because there's some common things that sometimes we look at celebrities and celebrities seem so perfect. But you've, I think, always been really honest about things you've been going through in your life. And this dug even deeper into it. So I do want to talk about that. How long were you filming that?
I started to film that, I think, way back in 2015. So for it to finally come together, it's really been a long time coming. And, you know, part of it was, you know, due to time.
Mm-hmm.
But another part of it was also, I felt like I was still in the process and kind of still in the oven baking and still trying to give birth to it. And, you know, to see it finally come together, it's beautiful. But the other side of it was that I was probably a little nervous, you know, to open myself up like that in that kind of a way. It feels like, you know, being completely stripped naked in front of the eyes of the world. And I think deeper than stripped naked, it feels like as if my body were turned inside out. It's been a long time coming, but I felt it was so necessary because everybody's so worried about
what people think.
Yeah. The purpose for me was to hopefully be a voice to people in the world by exposing myself through the art and hopefully allowing people to see themselves through it as well.
Yeah, I feel like watching, because I watched the docuseries before I listened to the album,
and
that helped because it was like I was able to connect your real life experiences to the music. So when you listen to a song, I'm like, okay, he talked about this in the documentary because it really is what you've been going through.
Yeah.
And 27 songs worth of it. That, by the way, has had an amazing response so far.
Yes, yes. And I think that's, it says a lot because 27 songs is a lot. And I know it's a lot for people to digest, but it's beautiful to feel that love and feel people embrace it, you know? And I truly do think it's because of other people getting to see themselves. I think the documentary definitely played a huge role. It allowed other people to be able to see themselves and see themselves through me and also be able to look at my family and see that we are really all more alike than we are different, you know?
You also have Tupac in there, kind of threading the story along.
Yeah, I mean, Pac is known to the world for his brilliant mind.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of the footage and things that he was hitting on is so relatable.
And he was so young at that time, I think people don't even think about.
Exactly, exactly. And I get to see myself through the thoughts that he sparks, you know, throughout the conversations, but it also shows how much a lot of life has been stagnant, and it hasn't really changed for so many people, especially for so many Black people. Because he's talking about oppression in there. And this is years ago when Pac was a child. Mm-hmm. He's talking about the way that Black people are treated. There has been a lack in forward movement and forward progression in the world when it comes to Black people and the culture of Black people.
Even family, like family is clearly so important to you. And I feel like we knew that. And your mother.
My mother.
I know that's so complicated to even.
Nah, but you know what though? I really wanna honor my mother. The way my mother has embraced me and supported me through this journey, you know, she really gave me a blessing to do whatever and speak my truth and really take accountability for a lot of the trauma that my brothers and my family we've encountered, you know? None of these things make our parents bad people. It just is, and these things are like teachable experiences and teachable moments. What I have now come to realize, because I think I used to really be hard on my mother just because I wanted a certain type of thing from my mother. And I feel like I've been forced to grow up in this world alone. But what I've realized about my mother is that there are certain things that has been deficient when it comes to may or may not have showed up for her. Like, I don't know my grandfather. Mm-hmm. I don't know her father, and he's alive, you know? My grandmother actually just passed in March. God rest her soul. I just remember her always saying, tough love. When anything would come up, tough love. You gotta give them tough love, dog, tough love. And, you know, I can only imagine what my mother's experience has been when it comes to her parents. And I don't really know my mother's story like that, right? Mm-hmm. It taught me to cut my mother some slack because I don't know her story. And there's no rule book, there's no blueprint to how to be a parent. And I think I've always wanted my mother to be a certain thing for me in my life, especially when I look at other people and, you know, whatever relationships they may have with their parents. My mother, she just didn't have it to give.
Right, it's like that generational, you talk about the PTSD from what we've seen, what we've experienced growing up, and so she may not have been able to give you.
Yeah, it's you. I mean, you only have the capacity for what you have the capacity for. It doesn't make you any less than or more than. People can only meet you where they have met themselves, right?
But I'm sure she also understands you feeling the way that you did.
Yeah, absolutely.
For so long.
Which is why it's so beautiful to just have her blessing. I feel like throughout my life, I don't ever actually feel like I've had my mother's support in the way that she's been supporting me throughout this journey to freedom. It's been the most beautiful experience. And my mother and I, we've come a long way. We got a lot further to go, you know? Mm-hmm. It's been a beautiful experience. And I honor her and I admire her for her growth. I really do.
Did she see this before it came out?
Mm-mm. Nope.
That she
saw
said anything?
She saw it like everybody else. She did. She hit me every night. And she, some nights she like, wow, August, God really has chosen you. God has put his hands on you. And the other night she like, I'm so emotional. And I'm in tears because it's just so beautiful. And, you know, it's a different thing when you get to see it in a different way, right? When you get to see something on film, I think it gives you a different perspective about your life, you know? And I think what's most important about this is that none of this is an attack on anyone. Any of the stories that I shared in the documentary isn't an attack towards anybody. It simply is me sharing my story and some of my life and how painful some of that has been to show how pain can be a gift for us. I think I used to complain a lot about the amount of massive, tremendous pain that I felt.
You've been through a lot, August.
It's been a lot. Yeah, it's been a really rough road. And a lot of times I really did believe that I would die. I truly believed that to come out on the other side, and I'm still in my process, you know, to be able to use it and show people that you can transform it. You know, that's real life alchemy. You can transform that pain into something that you would like it to be for yourself. And for me, I just wanted to use this to be able to put towards the offering in the healing of my family, you know, right. Because I think for so long there has been so many things that you have to walk around, right? And it's like all these elephants inside of this room. And it's no, I can't breathe in this motherfucker. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm suffocating. I need this off of me to make more room for what's actually supposed to be. But I can't maneuver around this anymore. It literally is the equivalent to someone's knee on my neck.
Right.
And I think Black people have been constantly told to shh. Mm-hmm. Everything you shut up about.
Everything.
Everything.
And like you said, you can't hear what you don't reveal.
Black people are expected, you take it on the chin. Oh, that's what you're supposed to do, because Black people are strong, right? Mm-hmm. But what happens when you are tired of being strong? And what happens when you are actually weak? Right. You know, we've been taught that since the beginning of time of Black people, we have been oppressed forever.
Mm-hmm.
Forever.
And it has not stopped, as we can see. Yeah. We're in the midst of all of that right now.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I think that this is a new time where the universe is requiring something different mm-hmm. from people. People are rising up and finding a strength within themselves from suffering from that type of oppression and suppressing so much stuff. Repressing so much stuff, pushing it down, pushing it down, pushing it down. And then what happens is my spirit and my mind and my body becomes bogged down and I am heavy. I can't move anymore. Mm. I can't operate my body.
Right.
And it starts to affect your nervous system, literally. My body starts to shut down from the amount of weight and pressure that I feel from just being quiet about every little thing. Everybody's got all these secrets, and you're supposed to whisper or don't say nothing about anything that you feel. Your feelings are not valid, and that's not cool.
I mean, you even talk about being molested and mm-hmm. your mom witnessing that. So was that a huge release for you to be able to say that?
Absolutely. With those kinds of situations, it can be so normal to you up until a certain age, right? And mm-hmm. then you realize, whoa, actually, that's not normal at all. And again, as I said in the documentary, that me expressing that wasn't even about the act, right? Because you can look up to a person so much and admire a person so much, and you're like, I love this person, I want to protect this person. But for someone to have tampered with you in that kind of way and still be able to have like this evil energy towards you, I don't understand that. But you know, narcissism is really real.
Yes, it is.
I mean, and those type of experiences, they affect you greatly, you know, psychologically.
You might not
right?
even realize it at the time.
Yeah, you don't really realize it while you in that moment, but it affects you when you don't speak on certain things. And I'm not saying that everybody should tell the world their business.
Right. You process things and deal with it how you deal with it.
Everything's not for everybody, but for me and what I felt called to do and felt led by God to do was to use my voice to help other people release whatever it is that they are feeling or whatever they're going through, because the world needs a real healing. Everybody's really hurting, as if people are waiting for permission, you know, from someone else to go after what it is that they feel like they want, to go after happiness, to go after freedom. So many people are waiting for permission for it. I just felt it very necessary to try and be that voice mm-hmm. and be courageous enough to be it, you know? And again, as I said, even in that situation, it doesn't define that person, who that person is. It doesn't make that person a bad person. I truly don't believe that.
Well, I guess that's difficult to say because that is...
It's difficult, but...
Certain things do make people bad people, I feel like.
I think certain things make people have made a bad decision in the moment. You never know what that person's history is, right? And I'm not saying that's an excuse, because it's not an excuse at all, but I do just want to acknowledge the fact that things happen to people that we don't know about, and people mistakenly or whatever repeat that thing and project it onto someone else. I'm not here to condemn anybody, right? And I'm not even here to judge you, because I'm at a space in my life where I only have love. I don't have the energy for anything else. I mean, that's how I feel with love. I feel. I don't have the energy to devote to anything negative because this life is tough, man. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I know that people make decisions that sometimes, you know, they may or may not have meant. You know?
Was there ever an apology or a recognizing?
Nah.
Well, okay.
Nope. I don't even need it, you know? I forgive myself, and when I can forgive myself for anything, I then create the space to be able to have forgiveness for you. People are lacking love out this motherfucker.
You have an episode on what is love.
Absolutely.
And one thing that people ask, like, who is August linked to romantically? Because you're never very open about that. Like, we've seen you, you know, out on dates, and we've assumed certain things. Mm-hmm. And I remember you put out this song, Nanya, and a lot of people were saying, okay, you know, August is dating Jada Pinkett Smith, and that was something that was circulating as a rumor, and that kind of solidified it to people. So what was the real situation with Jada Pinkett Smith? Because I don't know if you were pursuing her or you guys had just a close family type of relationship, and I would love for you to be able to shed that.
Here's what I'll say. People can have whatever ideas that they like, but what I'm not okay with is my character, you know, being in question. Mm-hmm. When certain things are questionable that I know is not me, or that I know that I haven't done, you know, contrary to what some people may believe, I'm not a troublemaker. You know, I don't like drama. Drama actually makes me nauseous, you know what I'm saying? And I also don't think that it's ever important for people to know what I do, who I sleep with, who I date, right? But in this instance, it's very different because, as I said, there's so many people that are side-eyeing me, looking at me questionable about it. I mean, I've lost money, friendships, relationships behind it, and I think it's because people don't necessarily know the truth, but I've never done anything wrong. Mm-hmm. I love those people, literally, like my family. I don't have a bad thing to say about them. They are beautiful people. You know, when something starts affecting my life, and not only affecting my life, but affecting my wellness and my well-being, and also starts to block my heart space is blocked. I don't really have a choice but to express my truth. I actually sat down with Will and had a conversation due to the transformation from their marriage to life partnership that they've spoken on several times, and it, you know, not involving romanticism. Mm-hmm. He gave me his blessing, and I totally gave myself to that relationship for years of my life, you know, and I truly and really, really deeply loved and have a ton of love for her. I devoted myself to it. I gave my full self to it. So much so to the point that I can die right now and be okay with knowing that I truly gave myself to somebody.
Right, you did the right thing.
And I really loved a person. I experienced that. I know what that feels like. And some people never get that in this lifetime. So I'm I know that I'm completely blessed. And this conversation is difficult because there's so much that it would be hard for people to understand. But once it starts to affect me and my livelihood, I have to speak up about my truth and stand on my 10 with anything that may come along with it.
Is it disappointing that she never addressed it to you? Because, like you said, you lost out on opportunities.
Yeah.
And if there's
I really can't even, I never even can get into the thought of that because I'm only responsible for myself, right? And I'm only responsible for, you know, what I do. When I'm repressing and suppressing things and it starts to affect me, I have to address it. I just always stay silent because I never want to be the person to cause confusion because I love these people.
Right.
I really genuinely do. And I have literally never been in love in that kind of a way. So much so that being intertwined in that way, walking away from it, butchered me. Like I'm shaking right now because
it almost
killed me.
It did.
It pushed me into being another person, my newer self. It broke me down. It was a part of me being paralyzed, trying to pull myself apart from it. It probably will be the hardest thing that I've ever experienced in this lifetime. And you know, it's difficult because I never want to be the person to cause any confusion or step on toes, right?
You want to be honest.
But I want to honor myself and I want to honor my authenticity. And if honoring my authenticity means you hate me, stone me, shoot me, crucify me, whatever, bury me an honest man.
I saw on the What Is Love episode, you also talk about just what love is, like two cars just crashing together. Mm-hmm. And you described after your sister passed away, just mm-hmm. having to disentangle yourself from that relationship.
That definitely played a huge role in it. You know, it hit different when you
take your time. It's fine.
It's a different experience when you're standing over your sister's dead body and she was just here and alive and then she's suddenly dead, right? And I remember standing over my sister and I was weeping, wailing. And I can remember my cousin kept pulling me off her, saying, "She gone, you gotta let her go." And little did she know, I wasn't only weeping about my sister, I was mourning myself. I was grieving myself as I knew it, because I died in that moment. Who I was, everything that I thought that I was, everything I thought I knew about myself, it died. And I couldn't be that human being any longer. I saw my sister die and she never got to live her full life. She was so afraid of everything, literally everything. Get my sister a car, she's scared to drive. She's never driven a car because she's scared to get on the interstate. After my brother got killed, she was scared of everything.
Right.
And she never lived her full life. And I just don't want to be that. I don't want to be that person. I want to live my life on full. I want to die empty. Whatever that means, giving myself to my three kids now,
mm-hmm.
giving myself to love or a relationship, giving myself to my career, devoting myself to being a healthy person, I have to give my full self to something because that's what makes me feel alive. So it lets me know that I have life in my body. Honestly and truly, love is really all that really is.
Yeah.
There's nothing else. We don't have anything else. All I have of my sister and all I have of my brother is the love that they have made me feel. And the love and memories with them. The love they have given me. The love that I've given to them in return. That's it. That's the only thing real. And I just don't want to do anything on this earth if it doesn't involve that any longer. Mm-hmm. Before, I was okay with that. Before my sister left this earth and she rocked my world because she showed me so much about what's true. I never get it back. But what I do have with me stays with me forever. And that's the way my sister loved me, supported me. My sister supported me so much that she got August, Team August, tatted on her when I was way younger. I don't even think I was famous. But they believed in me like that. My brother believed in me like that.
Right.
He lied to people when I was a kid, like, oh yeah, you know my brother, he got a deal, you heard me? Woo, woo, woo. He was manifesting that and he spoke that over my life.
Right.
All I have left of them is their beautiful kids. I just was telling my oldest daughter that I was like, wow. Because she been every day, like, hitting me super excited about, oh, yeah, uncle, it's going down. Like, do you know that you are August, baby? That she always said, right? And she supports me and she loves me in the way that she supports me. And her energy is unmatched. You know, she really reminds me of her mother with the way she go hard for me.
That's why I love that song on the album that you dedicated to your nieces.
Thank you.
Sincerely.
Yeah.
What did they say when they heard that?
They expressed themselves in very different ways, right? I think that a lot of times they are afraid to, like, express
show
love
emotion.
And show emotion.
Yeah.
It's tough, you know?
Because we're so programmed to act, like, cool and...
Yeah. It's tough. It's tough for... It's tough, and especially I think that they have experienced a certain amount of trauma and a certain amount of pain that really affects them. I'm just always, you know, trying to be there to remind them, like, yo, it's all love. They may not directly say something about it, but my oldest, she letting me know what's good off top, because that's just how she coming. But, you know, my youngest, she might, like, she'll send me a song, and she's singing it, right? And she's like, how does it sound? Is it really good? Like, don't lie to me. You know, she has a beautiful voice. My middle, she's so quiet. I think that she, a lot of times, is afraid to express herself. And I think also because I look so much like her father to her. Mm-hmm. That is scary, right? It's not foreign to me because I was always the weird kid in my house, right? I'm the only one that come from my father. All my brothers, they had the same father. My mama be like, yeah, he's my weird kid. That's my weird baby. And, you know, it's because I was so expressive, right? And I'm always, like, super loving, and I was always kind of the odd kid out. So, you know, I know that by continuing to be in the flow of love and continuing to express love and show them that it's okay. It's okay to feel. It's okay to feel anything you feel, whether good or bad. Sit with those feelings, sit with those emotions, and, you know, learn how to navigate through them. And I think that I'm just here to be of assistance in that journey for them, you know, through their emotions. But they excited. They are little creatives of their own, you know, and they're all into different things, and they have a drive and they want to do certain things in his life. I spent about 6 to 7 months in New Orleans and slept on a couch every day after my sister died to just be there, show up for them and be able to create a space for them to just completely fall apart. You're in the existential crisis,
right.
Be a foundation for you to fall apart and be whatever you need and just to be present. I was already planning to move out the crib in LA, and I'm like, yo, after those 7 months, I'm like, yo, I gotta get back to LA to check on the house, get everything moved out. You know, at first they're like, nah, you can't leave. And I'm like, yo, well, we can be broke. together. Y'all want to do that? Everybody can sit around here.
All right, well, call me when you.
Yeah. We could be broke together, you know. And then that the tune changes. Like, oh, okay, all right. You know, we'll see you when you get back, right? And so I finally got to get back to my own space, and then it didn't go as planned. I thought I would be right back in New Orleans and finding a spot out there for us. As soon as I got back into my own space, my body just started to decline. And it just hit me like a train, you know? And I think that being a safe haven for them and their emotions in that time, I never really dealt with my own. And I thought I did,
right?
You know? But I guess I was kind of neglecting it. And wasn't really aware of it. And
you're being strong for everybody else.
Yeah. So it hit me all at one time, and it's as if I was experiencing the same emotions over and over and over and over again, like Groundhog Day, right? Mm-hmm. And just reliving those same emotions, and you know, those toxins from stress and anxiety, it released in your body, and it literally started to eat at my nervous system. And before you know it, I'm looking in the mirror, not recognizing myself, face super swollen. I'm like looking like a demon. I try to get out of bed, and I hit the floor completely. Couldn't get myself back up. I'm trying to slide across the floor. I could not move.
And you were by yourself.
And I was by myself. You know, God put me in isolation for that whole process. God really sat me down. 3 days straight, I slept. And this is gonna sound crazy, right? For those 3 days, the fire alarms kept going off. Mm. Just randomly kept going off. Mind you, the fire department showed up, the security showed up to come turn it off, and it was still going off. And the housekeepers were letting them in to do all of this stuff, and it was still going off, would not stop. And they're like, well, we don't know why this is happening. There's no smoke, this shouldn't be happening. You're gonna have to get up and take them down. I slept in there with those fire detectors going off for all of those days, and I really feel like that was God telling me, yo, you are on fire.
Right.
Your body is on fire. I was sweating so hard that it would feel like I pissed in the bed. An unexplainable experience, and a really scary one too. You know, not knowing if you gonna live. It's crazy because, you know, I had a failing body, but a peaceful mind. But one of the things that has truly kept me here, kept me planted here, is the love for my nieces, man.
Right.
And what they give me, they like really bring me joy. Like my best friends, mm-hmm. like for real. And I just want to see them do well. I just want to see them thrive in life, you know, because I've grown up in this world, and I felt like I haven't had anyone, right? So I know what that feels like. For me, my gift has been, you know, people around the world making me feel like I have, you know, family in those moments.
And I know your sister was at peace knowing that you were there to take care of the
and
girls.
You know, and that's the thing. When she asked me, would I take custody? I'm like, of course. Mm-hmm. I never thought she would die. I'm thinking she's gonna be right. Fine. You're gonna shake back, because she shook back before, right? You know, the next week after that, she was gone. The wildest part about that situation is the happiest that I had ever seen my sister look on this earth is when she was laying on that table. She had a smile, had a smirk on her face, and she looked so full of life. My sister was suffering. I didn't notice at first, but she told the family, you know, that she ended up signing a do not resuscitate paper, right?
Oh, wow.
Because she was suffering, mm-hmm. but she told them not to tell me, because she know I would have been on it to, like, you gotta fight.
Right.
And fight for your your kids, fight for your life, fight for you, right? But she was miserable, man. And she just didn't wanna be here living like that, you know? And I will admit that I felt some type of way about that at first, right? Her signing the paper, but you know, losing my health in the way that I did and it making me lose myself, I get it. And I gave her that freedom, you know, to go on to your next chapter. I think that's a part of my issue is that I was in a fight with God about it. Like, how could you do this? Mm-hmm. That doesn't make sense. You wouldn't do that. Why would you do that? Because there are only certain things that a woman can give to a little girl. I just pray that in those spaces that I lack, you know, the universe and God will come in to nourish me with that and to be able to feed it to them and also be able to nourish them with whatever they need to survive on this planet.
You know, it feels like you're doing a great job with them.
You know, and you know what's even crazier is I've never been away from them this long, mm-hmm. but I really have been fighting for my health, going to immunotherapy, being there from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. It literally takes that long for the medicine. You know, it's to help boost my immune system. You know, they're like, all right, what's going on?
Right.
Are you coming? Because they didn't know that I was sick in the way that I was. And I didn't tell them because I just felt like that would be too much. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, death, it felt like, it feels like that death is chasing us, right? You know, but we gotta continue to choose life. I want life. And I want life for myself. I want life for my kids. I trust and believe that we have everything that we need for the journey. Yeah.
When did you decide to go to the doctor? Because a lot of people didn't know how serious. I remember at first they were saying August is losing his vision. Mm-hmm. You did have surgery.
Well, that's been a whole process. You know, my health journey has been a whole like roller coaster, right? It's just this crazy roller coaster ride that I've had to take into my own hands to begin to heal myself, because a lot of this comes from that press down mm-hmm. oppression that we do to one another. White people have done it to us forever, right? Mm-hmm. It's taught, we're programmed, and now black people do it to one another. So there is every form of oppression, every way you turn, we're all stuck. We all have a knee and a foot on our neck, and it creates so much animosity, you know? Black people don't trust each other.
Right.
Think about that.
Right, and we have to right now.
We all we got.
Yeah, we have to.
But in order to do that, we gotta break down certain barriers that we have built up and made ourselves believe about one another. And what I think that a lot of us don't realize is that that's not even us. It's who we have become mm-hmm. in order to survive
right.
in this world. But what's now being required is, okay, let's get out of survival mode with one another. We may have to, you know, do that here and there.
That divide and conquer really works too. They try mm-hmm. to divide
exactly.
us.
Exactly.
And then now we're fighting with each other mm-hmm. and doing the work for
mm-hmm.
them.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think that black people have been suffering so long and been at the bottom in the pits of hell for so long that it does feel like there's only room for only one of us mm-hmm. to have a seat at the table. And if I feel like you're getting too close and you might take my seat, I got to off you. It's off with your head. And I think that we all have to learn how to pull each other up in any way that we can. And I mean, that's mentally, spiritually. You know, we have to really teach each other how to love one another, because we all come from lovelessness in some kind of way. There's an absence, there's a lack. We are lacking in so many different areas. You know how I have to get immunotherapy to help build my immune system because I'm deficient. Mm-hmm. And it's the same way. just as I'm deficient with whatever nutrients or whatever my body needs that it doesn't create, where you don't have it, you beautiful black soul, how can I give you what you lacking and you do that for me in return?
Right.
With that reciprocity, right? We have a long road to toe. We really do. But I think it starts with us being able to love one another, and we have to teach each other what that is, because we don't even know what love looks like, a lot of us, or what it feels like. It's foreign to us. And we have to somehow be able to trust each other in some type of way, right?
You know, you start off the album with the song Nola.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And mm-hmm. I thought that was a great way to start, because people always say this, I want to talk about, you know, I want August to be the same August and throw it back to that. And
another form of oppression is what I'm saying. You don't fit the box or the picture that I've created for you. You're not in that box anymore. So you know what happens? Oh, you changed. Oh, you fake. Fame changed you. Oh, you gay. Because you don't look a certain type of way, or you don't dress a certain type of way. Your pants don't hang as low, so you're not black enough.
Mm-hmm.
You don't talk this way, so you're not black enough. And you know what we do? You get rid of your own people. You throw them away. You're disposable, right? And it's another form of oppression. And you trying to force me to be something that you want me to be. And we have to give each other the freedom to be who we are.
Right.
All of what we are.
And it is a journey, because think about when you first came out, where you were, what space you were in.
Absolutely.
And where you are now, you've been through.
I was just telling you earlier that I'm rooted the same. My core is here within me, but I definitely have evolved. I feel it, I see it, it's all in my face, it's all over my body. My spirit feels different, my DNA feels different. I have somehow become so sensitive to everything, like every little thing. I feel everything, and I have to work really hard to keep myself grounded and plan it, right? And also not let the outside noise get into me, because it's poison.
You know, it's such a balance, though, being sensitive and feeling everything as opposed to feeling nothing.
Yeah.
You know, it is a real
balance. I want to feel. I don't want
to. Yeah, you want to.
I want to be numb. I've done that. I want to feel everything.
Mm-hmm.
All that comes with it. It feels terrible. It hurts. It feels like murder. It feels like I'm being crucified. Give it to me. That's what lets me know I'm alive.
Right.
I don't want to be a zombie. Let me feel that. I named the project State of Emergency before the world was in a state of emergency. And I think that it's so, that's so crazy that the project comes out while the whole world is in a state of emergency. The idea of it is a play on words about how one's pain can be a gift. Yes, it hurts if it doesn't feel good, but your pain can be a blessing to you, and it can cause you to go, you know, either way. You run away from it, you numb yourself, or the other side is it causes you to emerge and see from a different view and a different perspective.
It also feels like you were learning about your dad.
Yes.
Somewhat while we were watching the documentary.
Absolutely, because I don't know much about him.
And it's interesting that just now some of these questions are getting answered. So.
Yeah, I've never known. But that's what I'm saying. I don't know the history of my family. And I think there's a lot of people who don't know the history of their family or where they come from. And, you know, how can we know ourselves? How can we even begin to know ourselves if we don't know anything about where we come from, the people we come from, you know? And that's a struggle in itself, having to go out into this world and try and be something for yourself when you have never seen an example. For me, learning about my father, it taught me so much, and it's teaching me so much. I used to really be mad at my father for being absent in my life. I was mad and angry at my father for being a drug addict. I now know, going through my illness and, you know, my grandmother and them explaining that my grandfather suffered from illness, my father suffered from illness, it took them out. They couldn't survive it. And me experiencing that and the amount of pain, I understand why you started to self-medicate. Mm-hmm. Here I am, I have the resource, at least more resources than they did, to be able to get into places and get into these doctors to try to see what's going on. But I know what it's like when my grandmother is saying that my father would show up to the hospital and he's suffering, and the doctor is telling you, oh, you look, everything seems to be fine. You don't know what to do with that. You're suffering. So that also has helped to release a lot of my anger. I feel like my drive in this life has been anger. Everything that I have ever accomplished mm-hmm. has come from anger. That's been my drive. That's what gets me going. Once I'm mad, I will add this bitch out.
Right.
Clean out.
We don't want that guy back.
Nah, straight up. You know what I'm saying? Once I get mad, that's it. That's so many black people's drive, mm-hmm. right? And there's a part in the documentary where I talk about black families growing up around the use of crack, right? Whether it's being sold or used, whatever. And I know some people kind of felt a little way about that because it's like, oh, well, all black people don't go. And so I never said all black people. Black people, where I'm from, we really from the trenches.
Listen, New York, it was really bad.
And it, who was it?
Right.
It was our black people. Yeah.
It was put in our communities.
It's our people. And you know, now, white people are also experiencing that with
opioids.
Exactly, right?
But now that's more treated like a sickness and not a crime.
Whereas when crack was happening, that's a crime. And
mm-hmm. You're going to jail for using it.
Yeah.
You're going to jail.
And not only that, we're going to judge you about it. Mm-hmm. When, you know, people are suffering, people trying to patch up those wounds. And when you can't figure out how to get through that, you start to self-medicate. When I was sick and in the hospital, woke up from that coma and my body was hitting me and hurting me, and they continued to give you these pills, and you taking it because you need help.
And they're highly addictive.
Yes, and you're not even realizing. Then you just up and you try and stop, and you're like, whoa. That pain feels like being hit by a bus. You know what I'm saying? And people will, you know, try and talk about it and, you know, use it in a way to degrade you. Oh, you had an addiction, this, that, and the third. And it's like, yo, I can shake anything that I want to in this life. And no one would have ever known that if I never shared it.
Right.
This experience has taught me so much about allowing people to go through their journey and not being so judgmental, because you don't know what people are dealing with. People are not junkies just to be junkies.
Mm-hmm. Even you being so vulnerable, showing yourself in the
Absolutely.
Hospital in the documentary and saying, mm-hmm. look, I don't want people to feel bad for me mm-hmm. because I'm sick, or treat me differently
yeah. Yeah.
because of this sickness that I have. That's not an easy yeah. thing to it's, reveal to people.
Absolutely, it's not. Because as I said before, I would process it as a weakness. I
learning how to walk people. Again.
Yeah, learning
that's
how
real.
To talk again. Mm-hmm. I couldn't talk.
And that could end your career.
Absolutely.
Clearly, that's what you do.
I was afraid for a while, you know? And then it's just like, yo, well, it's going to be what it's going to be. I got to give it to God. But I couldn't speak. I had to teach myself how to talk again. I didn't know what Guillain-Barré syndrome was before I was diagnosed with
That's
it.
That's the first time I heard of it, was because of you.
I never heard of it before. It's so scientific. I'm reading up on it, and it's like the perfect storm of things has to happen, like a mixture of some like food, a massive amount of stress, and like some type of something, and then it just eats your nerves. And it ate my nerves inside of my legs. And I was done for. And I had to fight for my life. I was in the hospital, had to go to physical therapy rehab, and I'm still fighting for my life. Still teaching myself to get stronger, to be able to move around. You know, I'm not at 100%. Mm-hmm. I'm not. I wouldn't even lie to you. My body knows when it starts to need my immunotherapy sessions. I start to drop and I start to crash, right? And it's like, okay, yeah, it's time. I need that assistance to kind of help give me that boost. I do think there hasn't been any awareness on Guillain-Barré syndrome, and it can happen to anybody.
Right.
And it can happen to you like that. And it will sit you down. The doctors were telling me, it's good that you got in here when you did, because you could have died.
Right.
That's another reason in me sharing it is to bring some kind of awareness.
Yeah, because that could happen to someone you didn't know what it was. Mm-hmm. The doctors didn't know what it was.
Mm-hmm.
It took some time. And you know what I was thinking about, too, the other day, is we used to have these conversations, right, when you first came out, about how hard it was for you to celebrate or even, like, enjoy any type of success. And part of what you talk about is, like, bracing yourself for something bad to happen and not being able to accept just these blessings.
You're
and
always,
still like, having this, like, anxiety about, like, okay, something bad.
You're always on the edge of your seat. Always, like, and you always brace for impact, like, you can never get settled. So many bombs have gone off in our lives that you are always expecting it. I can remember being at school, coming home from school, and my mother and my stepfather would fight so much, it would always go down, we would always have to run away. I started to look forward to it. At first, I'm afraid, right? And you know, even as an adult, I'm still trying to shake that from it, just the rumblings inside my house, right? And being so afraid as a kid. It's gonna go down in the house today and we gonna get to run away and go to a motel. It's like, you know, a little kick dope getaway, right? It starts to become fun and chaos starts to become your normal. You know, for me, I'm just like trying to tear down all those walls of dysfunction and chaos and that I've created as my normal, you know, because that's not normal.
Right, that's well, not. Listen, I'm happy to see that you have put out this project, though.
Thank you.
So let's talk about it, because I know we've been talking about so many different things, and part of that is because as I was watching the documentary, I had so many questions, but like I said, it does so much, you know, relate back to what you talk about in the music. And there is some fun stuff in there too.
Yeah.
We know you still like going to the strip club.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I like to see things. I'm a visual person. I like to see things. And you know, the more you experience in life, the more you experience love, the more you can actually talk about things, right? I think the funniest thing is there's in this conversation still happens to this day where, you know, so many people are concerned about, girl, he don't eat vagina.
Oh, that's my fault that people think that.
Yes, now, listen. Exactly. You created this.
And first of all, and I told you this, right? Mm-hmm. Some of your fans hated me after that because they thought that we had like a situation and I would go places and they'd be like, oh, she messing with August and she was. And I'm like, nah, me and August are cool. And it would be like fun conversation to me. You know, obviously you did lip service. You were one of the first people when I brought it back.
Yes, I did.
That did my podcast.
Your very first episode, right?
Yeah, you showed us some pictures of yourself.
I just was saying that, I was just talking about this the other day. I'm like, yeah, I remember doing Yee lip service. And
you
used
to send out dick pics.
I'm young, dumb, full of cum, and I'm like, oh, y'all like, oh, we want to, can we see your dick? I'm like, sure, why not? You know, and I look at, it's crazy because I look at those videos now and I'm like cringing at them. Like, wow, like, what are you doing? You know what I'm saying? But that's what being young and, you know,
right.
Ready. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah, just young and ready, you know? But like I said, things change, man. You know, once you experience a certain type of love in this life, you want to please your lover in any way possible.
Okay, so you're saying you do eat vagina now?
I mean, absolutely.
Okay, all you have to say.
I'm grown. And what I'm saying is, I never said that I don't eat vagina.
Right.
Never said that I don't eat vagina. I'm just saying that I didn't eat everybody's vagina.
Okay, just a select few.
That means absolutely. Right. Because I know several people who literally will eat anybody's box.
Okay.
You put your mouth on anything.
Right, seafood connoisseurs.
And I'm just, exactly, and I'm just.
But you still haven't swam to the butt yet, right?
No. Okay. Not yet.
It's right there, it's right
there. Not yet.
Okay, so you haven't been in love yet.
I mean, I've been in love, but I got a complex with poo, man. I don't really enjoy poo.
Well, we don't want you to eat that. There's a difference.
I mean, poo is clean. But poo, that's where it's at.
After the shower, after a bath maybe, some salt water in the ocean.
You might gotta dig up in there and make sure nothing is there.
So it's not off the table.
If I get a speck in my mouth, I'm a...
After all you've been through, that's what makes you traumatized?
Yeah, I'm traumatized because you know what happened?
Oh, God. You had an experience.
I did. I've had an experience one time, and she, kind of sharted on me, and I was like...
Oh, wait, so you were you doing anal and she
sharted? I tried it.
Okay, tried to.
I tried it.
Okay.
And it didn't work.
From the picture that we saw, I don't know if you're the one that should be breaking people in that way, but.
I plead the fifth on that right there. You know?
So you think you'll ever be in love like you were in love again? Or do you look forward to that? Or you think that was just something that could never be? Was that like a soulmate? Do you believe in that?
Absolutely, I do. I believe in that, absolutely. And soulmates can come in many forms. In the form of friends, mm-hmm. lovers, whatever. I think that experience was really tough for me and took a lot out of me that, I don't know. I don't know if I am even prepared for a relationship.
I saw you said you were celibate now.
Yeah, I haven't had sex in so long.
What's so long?
It's wild. Probably like going on 3 years now.
Wow, that is a long time.
Yeah, it's been a long time. But I haven't even really necessarily had a huge desire. I think there's something that I was researching called demisexual. Demisexuality, basically you are sexually attracted to people that you feel emotion from, right? Whereas back in the G, I just used to be able to hit something like, what's good?
Yeah, I've heard.
Yeah. I just used to be able to hit whatever, and now emotions have to be involved,
I know, you said that your penis had low self-esteem at that point.
there was a time where my penis did have, low self-esteem. There was definitely a time, and I would hit anything with two legs. Mm-hmm. Hit anything
and a vagina.
Yeah.
Let's make sure.
I would hit anything with two legs and a vagina. I mean, after you do so much of that, it gets old to you.
And it feels like you want love so
absolutely,
bad.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I love love. Mm-hmm. A lot of people kind of have been confused about me or whatever because I know sometimes, I be tripping or whatever. You see certain clips or glimpses of a person and you think that this is who this person is, when they're angry or whatever. I'm a lover. It's something that I desire, but it's not something that I look for, If mm-hmm. it shows up, it shows up.
It has to be natural. Yeah. I love how you flip Tank song on the album.
Thank you.
You know
that's a part of me growing up. You go from a song like Porn Star to As Soon As I Walk In, right? That's a part of evolution and experiencing a certain type of love here on this planet. And when I used to listen to Marvin Gaye or Luther, they really made you feel something. and you can visualize, you can actually see it through the lyrics that they sing, what that love feels like and what it looks like. And that's just the kind of place that I'm, you know, trying to evolve into. And I know we were talking earlier about how 27 songs can seem like a lot. This was solely for my core base.
Right.
To reactivate them and feed them for all the years that I had been not putting out music. It's for them, you know, and giving them that allows me to be able to, on my next project, continue my evolution when it comes to, you know, my art and in my music.
Was there ever a time you thought you didn't want to do music anymore?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I still, even now, I question it a lot because it takes a lot out of me. You know, I think people don't really know, like, it affects me. Like, it's hard work to tour and your body doesn't feel like you can do it.
Man, I was at the Highline Ballroom when you passed out on the stage.
Really?
I was there that night.
Yeah.
And then you were in a coma after, and I remember
yes.
It was a big secret. Like, mm-hmm. Nobody can know mm-hmm. that August is in the mm-hmm. hospital. He's in a coma.
Yes.
It's really bad.
Yes.
And so,
yes.
You know, people just thought it was exhaustion, because it is exhausting.
Yeah, absolutely. It was literally from exhaustion and not really properly taking care of myself and not nourishing myself in the way that I should. But, you know, people don't really understand how taxing this is. It's hard work and trying to do what I feel called to do, but not necessarily feeling like I have the strength to be able to do it all the time. And also, like I said, you know, as my spirit evolves, I, for whatever reason, become more and more sensitive
right.
and have to work really hard to fight off all the outside energies and the outside noise, you know, not let the poison in.
One thing I noticed too, watching your documentary, you're a good interviewer.
Really?
You were asking questions, and I was like, look,
you
were kind of hosting.
I appreciate that, you know, I try. but I actually am really interested in people, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I think so many different kind of people in the world, and I'm just always like, you know, what's going on in your world? You know, again, trying to see myself in others, because we all are so alike than we think. Everybody think we so different and we out here by ourselves, but a lot of us are actually alike. I do enjoy producing, directing. I have a love for it. You know, it really is like giving birth to a baby, because, you know, you're spending all this amount of time with it baking, right? And then it's finally time to come to life. It's so beautiful, you know?
One thing I saw people talking about online is a song, If We Break Up.
Yes.
And some of the petty things that you would do. Have you ever done any of those things? Like, what are some of the pettiest August Alsina breakup stories?
This is what I'm saying. In the song, I said I'm high and I'm tripping. Hypothetical. It's a hypothetical, you know.
You've done some things though, because there's no way you just make that up.
It's a hypothetical. You know how you smoke and you like your brain just kind of goes off into, and I'm like, girl, I hope it never happens, because it's hard to imagine how it would be completely different, like between you and me if we broke up. Those things really could happen. I think that it is a, you know, the petty me inside. He's in there.
Are you friends with all your exes?
What do you consider friends?
Like happy birthday messages, maybe y'all could grab a meal.
Well, I actually don't have too many exes.
Okay. How many do you have, you would say?
Probably three.
Mm-hmm.
With one of those, I wasn't even, mature enough in that time, so it didn't even feel like a relationship.
Did you guys live together?
No, absolutely not.
Have you ever lived with anybody?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and see you every day, and you know, and that's the thing, when you break away from that, when you try and break away from that after you've been living a certain way for so long, that's a tough and excruciating thing to do. It really is.
Well, I know we could talk for hours and hours and hours, and I know we'll do this again.
Absolutely.
But I want you to give us just having to deal with everything you've gone through mm-hmm. in and out of the hospital and not knowing what was going to happen. What are some of the lessons that you would leave us with?
The biggest lesson for me has been to always strive for more, always strive for something different and to be comfortable with being uncomfortable. And mm-hmm. that's a really hard thing to do, but those uncomfortable places and those tight places forces you to rise up or get crushed.
I agree with that. I always say if I'm too comfortable, that means I gotta do something more.
Yeah, I need to do something different. So many people in the world are stuck and afraid to be their true selves because everybody's so afraid of what the next person is gonna say or how the next person is gonna feel. And of course, we don't wanna offend anyone. I don't wanna offend anyone. That's never my intention. Mm-hmm. But when the fear of staying the same is greater than the fear of change, it's time to change.
Right.
I don't wanna be stuck. I don't want your foot on my neck. I don't want your knee on my neck. I don't wanna walk around elephants. I wanna feel freedom. That's what we as Black people have been fighting for our whole lives. We're asking for freedom. Asking. We're banging, begging, we singing tunes for freedom. But we won't actually give the gift of freedom to ourselves. But we're asking everybody else to free us. And I think that the journey to freedom from everyone else starts with you being brave enough mm-hmm. to free yourself
yes.
first. That's all I got.
That's a lot. Well, thank you, August. I always appreciate you, and thank you for just being so great to me for all these years.
You know, I got a lot of love for you.
I have a lot of love for you, too. I really appreciate it. And it's an honor for me to be able to sit here and do this interview with you because this album is such an important album. Like I said, it's only been out for one day, so I've managed to listen to it like 3 times. But, you know, this is the kind of album you do have to sit with mm-hmm. and go through and find different favorite songs as you're listening to it. Mm-hmm. So it's much appreciated, and I highly tell everybody just watch the documentary also, and it'll help you connect even better. That's why I think being able to write music is important because those experiences, right, it's different when someone just gives you a song than when you can also
absolutely. When your life
even co-write or express your
DNA
own feeling.
Is in it. I'm all over, you know, the project. I'm all over it. But yeah, man, thank you for being a part of my journey. I literally love you. I love everyone for that matter, but I literally
That didn't feel so special when you said that just now.
I just want people to know that I really do have love for everyone. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I do. I got love for everybody. I want to see everybody win. I want to see everybody eat. But as for you in particular, I'm thankful for this moment. It's been very freeing for me, and I feel like a lot of weight has been lifted off of me, and I'm just thankful to you for assisting me in this journey. And you've always done that. You've always been in my corner. You've always supported me since the very first time. And I'm just thankful for who you are. I really admire you as a woman and how you hold it down in this business. And I just think
you're
dope.
August.
Straight up, you dope.
I really appreciate that. That means a lot to me.
Always, it's always love.
All right, well, thank you, August Alsina. Make sure y'all stream it, buy it,
yes,
do whatever
sir.
You have to do. Number one album.
Let's get it! Let's get it!
August. All right.